My kindergarten teacher was named Miss Barbara. Her name was Barbara Drugan. And when she came to Bexley to teach us, she was in her early 20s, and she stayed on forever, teaching kindergarten at Cassingham Elementary. And she finally retired. She never married. She never had children of her own. In the 1990s, I believe it was, they needed a patrol guard. And they had a meeting in the community to ask, will someone volunteer to be the patrol guard at the corner of Cassingham and Fair? And one person showed up to volunteer, and it was Barbara Drugan. She ended her life as she had begun her adult life, protecting those kids on the way to school. In the rain, in the snow, she'd be there. And when she passed away, the community erected a little plaque in honor of Miss Barbara. And there's where this woman spent her life. First, teaching the children of Bexley, and then at the end, standing there every day in the worst weather, in the hot, in the rain, in the snow, to make sure those kids got to school in Bexley safely. And when I pass that corner every day and I see that plaque, I think that's what this town is.
Support for Columbus Neighborhoods is provided by... Since 1921, the State Auto Group has called Columbus Neighborhoods home, offering personal and business insurance through independent insurance agents. For your car, home, and business, the State Auto Group. As we've grown and changed with Columbus, we've never lost sight of one thing. We are neighbors serving neighbors. Chase and its more than 15,000 Central Ohio associates are proud to celebrate the historic neighborhoods of Columbus. American Electric Power Foundation, a resource for charitable initiatives and communities served by AEP and beyond to improve people's lives through education, basic needs, healthcare, and the arts. The law firm of Bailey Cavalieri, a local firm with a national presence, baileycavalieri.com. And by these and other local foundations and families, and viewers like you. Thank you.
Three and a half miles. That's all that separates Columbus, Ohio, the nation's 15th largest city, from what feels like quintessential small town America.
We were at one point, I imagine, a buggy ride from downtown, so we were sort of off in the country. Right now we are truly surrounded on all sides by Columbus, and it's just a great bedroom community.
It feels a part of Columbus. It feels a part from Columbus.
Well, Bexley's a little bit like Groundhog Day in that every day is a new sunrise and the beauty of this place. The seasons change, and so sure. And yet, it's a very dependable, predictable, loving sort of place.
Yeah, it's tempting to idealize the place you grew up. And I think the lucky thing about being from this place is you don't have to do much fantasizing to idealize it.
Even ideal communities face challenges, despite the fact that the city limits and the population have remained virtually unchanged for decades. Change is inevitable. But on a Sunday afternoon, people are walking through central Bexley to enjoy something that hasn't changed: the beautiful, mature trees. So plentiful that the entire city has been designated an arboretum. It's the only town that can make such a claim.
It's not like, you know, we woke up one day and decided we should change a lot of things and become an arboretum. It was more of a realization that, you know what, we actually fit all the criteria for an arboretum. Let's claim that and let's continue to develop it. But it's already in our DNA.
you walk around now as an adult, and the trees are just remarkable. But when you're a kid growing up, you've never seen any other place. So you think every town is like this. And then you find out later in your life, of course, that every town is not like this.
In the summer, the shade is great, and I just like the feel of the big old trees. It just isn't more picturesque than that.
Bexley's a great city, and we love the Arboretum status. Yeah. We're one of a kind.
Bexley's reconnecting with the natural features that attracted its first inhabitants. You can rent a kayak from the city and float down Alum Creek, retracing the movements of the people of the Adena culture. When the first houses were built here along Alum Creek, axes, knives, points, and human remains were exposed when a mound was raised.
And now there are houses and driveways and mansions on that property. It's right near where Wolf Park is right now. And it was very clear exactly where it was because we found old maps, the early maps, that showed where the mound was located.
Those folks are going to be followed by the historic Indian tribes, the Wyandot, the Delaware, the Shawnee, all of whom are gone by the time European settlers come here. Lucas Sullivan in 1797, establishing Franklinton. David Nelson, about the same time, along Alum Creek.
Well, they were probably our pioneers, and they built a log house along Alum Creek. They owned a great deal of property, what is now Bexley, and some which is Columbus. Their house that they built after the log house is still standing on Nelson Road. But they were very prominent people in developing this area because they had farms, they had a mill, a grist mill that they built. It was the first business, really, I suppose, in this area.
Well, in 1811, the National Road began Frederick, Maryland, moving its way west. By 1831, it had reached central Ohio and had arrived at what is now Bexley.
The National Road was very important in the development of all the communities in the West because it brought dignitaries and people from the East, but it also brought the produce and the animals from the West to go to the East. And so it developed the businesses and the farms in the whole area. It was very helpful in the development of Bexley.
Bexley wasn't even a dream or a glimmer. There were scattered farms and a small village called Pleasant Ridge. But 3.5 miles to the west, Columbus was a boomtown. By 1876, a Lutheran university and seminary, located on what we today call the Cap on High Street, wanted out of the city.
There was a potpourri of immigrants there, Italian, German, and otherwise, and the fathers of the institution decided the boys, and they always called them boys, the boys needed to move to a more bucolic setting.
They wanted to get away from the sins of the city to the beautiful countryside, and that's exactly what happened.
It was outside the city and therefore away from temptations, but it was close enough because the car line, the old horse-drawn streetcar line, ended on the west side of Alum Creek, somewhere about where the railroad overpass is now. The area around the seminary was very German and very Lutheran for a long time. Once the faculty began to move to what is now Bexley, then they founded Christ Church. And then other people had reasons to live nearby. So there was a reason for the German Lutherans to kind of cluster around the university and the seminary.
Just a little north, an area on Broad Street would be affected by Spanish-American war fever taking over the country in 1898 with the sinking of the USS Maine.
The government felt that we needed to get into the fray, and so they called up the Ohio Volunteers, and they set up a camp, and it was a fantastic campground. There were tents, and there were horses. They had a cavalry there, and this is where they gathered. There are a lot of fun stories to tell about how the community responded. They took food. They also had people come in all kinds of conveyances. The streetcars came out to this area. So it developed a sewer system, which was helpful in developing Bexley after they all left.
Camp Bushnell was just down Broad Street from one of Columbus's most unusual homes, the Sessions Octagon House.
It's an early house. At the time it was built in the 1850s, it was well outside the city. Bexley wasn't even a concept yet. The octagon is fairly rare. There may be 20 or fewer in Ohio, and there are some in other states, but they're not very common. They were the product of an unusual mind. Orson Squire Fowler was his name. And he had a theory that living in an octagon would help solve physical ailments, mental ailments. He thought that octagons could cure sexual perversion, for example, and that was how you improved your health by living in an octagon.
The wealthier families in Columbus started out living around State House Square, but with time they began to move east. And as the city grew and developed, they moved further and further east out toward what is now Franklin Park. By the turn of the 20th century, the wealthier folks in Columbus had crossed Allen Creek.
A lot of those families came east to Bexley to develop nice mansions along what is now Parkview and Columbia, the north end of Bexley. And Mr. Jeffrey was one of them that came here and built what we call now the Jeffrey Mansion.
The Jeffrey Manufacturing Company was a major Columbus industry for many years. They were known best for producing coal mining machinery. That's where they had their niche and made the family fortune. Robert Jeffrey was the son of the founder, Joseph Jeffrey, and built this house in Bexley in 1905.
In the early 20th century, there were really two major communities east of Alum Creek. One was the Pleasant Ridge community along Main Street, where Capital University is located. The other was the Bullet Park neighborhood up along East Broad. They were two very different communities in many ways, but they shared one great concern. They didn't want to be part of Columbus.
They wanted their separate community, and they were going to be taxed by Columbus, and they didn't want that to happen. So they decided that they would come together so that they would have the power to overcome this threat that they had in the community.
So representatives of those two communities met over on the back porch of the Jeffrey Mansion and agreed to form a new community. The problem was they didn't have a name.
But Lincoln Kilbourne had an idea. Which Lincoln Kilbourne isn't clear. There were two of them. The Kilbournes were a respected and wealthy family that had built east on Broad Street. Lincoln Kilbourne had been researching a book about where his English ancestors had lived.
Actually, the book was a surveying book that one of his family had written.
Kilbourne suggested Bexley, the name of the town in England where his family had originated. The year was 1908. The two communities on either side of Main Street, east of Columbus, had joined. This new village embraced the name suggested by Kilbourne. The country lanes and farms surrounding Bullet Park and Pleasant Ridge gradually began to change as streets were laid out and houses built. But initially, Bexley, like other communities, placed restrictions on who could live there.
Bexley was closed, Upper Arlington was closed, Berwick was closed. All of those areas had restrictions in a lot of the deeds. I don't know if it was every deed, but they certainly had them in a lot.
For more than a half century, the Jewish community in Columbus was located on the south side. As the descendants of the original European immigrants prospered, they began a group migration to the east.
We don't know why the families specifically came to Bexley at the time that they did, but we do know that there were three families who, in April of 1920, actually closed on homes in Bexley. And those were the first three Jewish families that we know of.
I know families that have lived in Bexley since the 1920s. Going back rather far, Jews have been a significant presence in the Bexley community.
The Jewish families tended to move east because they followed their stores, they followed their synagogues. Through the 1920s and 30s, there were some Jewish families settling there. When you get to the post-war period and the baby boom and economic upturn, you start to see a lot more of these families who'd still been living in maybe the Donelson Road area or even Driving Park begin to move out east. So that included Berwick, Eastmore, and Bexley, of course.
Bexley was outgrowing the village designation it was given in 1908. The population increased nearly fourfold in the 1920s to more than 7,000.
Bexley is essentially an automobile suburb. It's a commuter community, which Many of these arose around Columbus in the years after the development of the Model T and the rise of the automobile. They tend, in some cases, to be highly intensively planned communities, but in Bexley's case, houses are being built sort of one house at a time.
Many of the homes and buildings associated with Bexley today were being built. Bexley High opened in 1922 on East Main Street. A junior high and elementary school were built on Cassingham in 1927. The high school moved into a new adjoining building in 1932. The old high school became Montrose Elementary. St. Charles, a private school for boys, opens in 1925. The owner of one of the nation's largest automobile headlight factories lived at 56 Columbus Avenue, a house that will one day be the location of the Columbus School for Girls. In 1925, Roy Wentz took over the drugstore at Drexel in Maine. It would go through several remodelings and a fleet of delivery motorcycles before it closed after 64 years of business. Other businesses, such as the Glass Bowl Restaurant, which was built in 1938, didn't last as long. In this case, only 30 years. But to many people, Main Street was and is an essential part of the community.
So as you're driving down Main Street, you come in, you see the trees and the medians, you see the brick crosswalks, you see people walking, the restaurants and shops and the Drexel and Capitol, the library, the synagogue, the churches. There's just this vibrance to Main Street.
It seemed like everything we did was on Main Street because everything was here. If you wanted food, you had Rubino's, you had the Tuttle House, you had the Feed Bag. The movies, you had the Drexel. The knowledge of the world, you had the Bexley Public Library. You could live your life, at least we so assumed, on Main Street in Bexley.
It seems to me that what people, a lot of people are searching for these days is a sense of community. And people seek it in all kinds of ways. You got little neighborhood shops and stores that change over time, but still they're constantly, there's a presence there, and everybody flocks to Main Street to get a pizza. Oh, that all goes together to make Bexley a real community-minded area.
But one of the Main Street institutions nearly didn't make it.
If you wanted to be entertained, you went to the corner movie theater, and so the Drexel was a big deal.
But the theater, built in the Depression, was just about to go dark in the 21st century.
And we came to a group conclusion that the only way for the Drexel to be able to sustain itself in the future was to become a nonprofit. And so that's where we formed Friends of the Drexel.
And the Friends of the Drexel got help from a Bexley boy who had hit the big time.
Josh Radner came to us and said that he was about to launch his first film, Happy Thank You More Please, and wanted to see if we could do that as the premiere at the Drexel and raise money for the restoration of the Drexel Theater.
The Friends made improvements to the building, went high-tech with the projection, and turned day-to-day operations over to Kappa. And they were surprised to learn this neighborhood theater drew people from all over.
Only 20% of the people that come to the Drexel are from the 43209 zip code. Only 20%. 60% are from other places inside of 270, and 20% are from outside of 270. So people are coming to the Drexel from all over Central Ohio. People feel that they are not just coming to a big box, but they're coming to something that has character to it, something that is part of the fabric of this community. Everybody talks about the Drexel as my Drexel, not just the Drexel. So it's something that people here really take a lot of pride in.
Not everyone traveling Main Street has Bexley as their destination. Every day, thousands of people use Main Street, the National Road, Highway 40, to get through Bexley. Just as in the early days of the National Road, merchants would like more people to stop and spend money. Others are intent on preserving Bexley's small town character.
Main Street in Bexley is trying to build up restaurants, ice cream parlors, a high-class movie theater, things that should attract people from other parts of Columbus.
I think every peaceful neighborhood and peaceful town, if it's successful, has that heart, has that core, has somewhere for the community to gather and to congregate. And I think that's what Main Street is for Bexley.
One of the places to gather on Main Street is the Capital University Lawn. At the annual 4th of July celebration, everyone's looking forward to the evening's fireworks, but Capital University is a Bexley institution that's been around long enough to invite comparisons between the present and the past.
Capital University student today, for example, takes most of his classes or her classes in English. 100 years ago, most, if not all, the classes delivered here were delivered in German. 100 years ago, most of our students really lived nearby. And increasingly, students at Capital University include out-of-state students and international students. Today, many of our students are first-generation students. Their parents might be well off, they might not be well off, but in both of those cases, their moms and dads aren't entirely familiar with higher education. 100 years ago, the courses with the largest enrollments were Latin and ancient Greek. 100 years later, Latin and Greek are probably the courses that are not very well enrolled, although those courses are still taught. We also teach our students to think differently because we value creativity, we value innovation, and we want our students to be leaders.
That creativity and innovation can be seen in Capital's Conservatory of Music. Capital musicians can be found in churches and schools in Ohio and beyond, but Capital realized its conservatory had to do more.
It was the first institution in the Midwest to offer a jazz studies major in 1976.
And so, a conservatory that began as a place to create musicians for Lutheran churches today has a wider focus.
Music technology students will study the specifics of the business, they'll talk about the gear, they'll talk about all of the associated elements related to music technology, which means film production and sound production and live sound. And so it's really up to our students to know how to operate the equipment now and how to anticipate what might happen in the future.
We have sent wonderful professionals out into the population, to the symphony downtown. I'm amazed every time I go into a high school these days, I find another Capital graduate now conducting the choir.
That's one of the reasons why the chapel choir, which is one of our key ensembles, has maintained the profile that it has.
Christ Lutheran Church on Main is a reminder of the many German Lutherans who originally settled this part of Bexley, but it intentionally looks less German than the congregation's original building.
It was at the corner of Drexel and Main, but when they built a new church a block away in the 1920s, I believe it was, then they adopted a more English style of architecture, which would be more characteristic of Episcopalians in this country than of Lutherans. And Christ Lutheran wasn't the only church to do that. They were under tremendous pressure during the First World War, and even for quite a while afterwards. And so the less obviously German they were, the better off they were. As a historian, one of the things that interests me is the history of immigration and assimilation. I believe the assimilation is inevitable. But how it happens and when it happens and so on, that's the story.
Bexley's Jewish population continued to grow, and members of that community were thoroughly involved in Bexley's schools, businesses, and government. Still, there were barriers.
My bar mitzvah party was at the Excelsior Club, not a fancy schmancy place. There were other places much nicer, but our family, we weren't into fancy schmancy kind of things.
The Excelsior Club was started by a group of Russian Eastern European Jews. They weren't a part of the Winding Hollow group, and the Jewish Center hadn't been built yet. So this really was a community for the people that had come from this background.
The Excelsior Club was a response to the fact that Jews weren't allowed in some of the other country clubs in town. So the Jews said, okay, we'll build our own place. What's interesting is I don't remember being real conscious of that back then. I don't think my parents ever said to me, Bill, this is why we have the Excelsior Club. They won't let us in anywhere else. You know, looking back, I understand all these things. But when you're a teenager in the 1950s and 60s, you just live your life. You don't do a whole lot of sociological analysis.
Bexley is not as Jewish as most people think, but Bexley certainly has the highest concentration of Jewish population of any community in Columbus. Bexley, my understanding, is about 20-25% Jewish. It's certainly not the predominant group in Bexley, which is a fairly small community to begin with.
How much to be a part of and apart from something? It's the question Lutherans faced building a church. It's the question Bexley faces as a small town surrounded by a big city. And it's something people of many faiths consider, including Jews in Bexley.
The issue of assimilation has always been a sort of a two-edged sword. On the one hand, you know, you want to assimilate to the community in which you are living. And on the other hand, you want to maintain the traditions of your faith and of your history.
Columbus has had a lot of different ethnic communities, German, Irish, Italian, and so on. When these communities acculturate and begin to spread out into the rest of the area, they generally go in all directions. The Jewish community is somewhat different. It migrated as a group and headed east.
As a few people moved, the rest of the organizations moved, and then the rest of the population moved. They really felt very comfortable being close to their stores and their synagogues.
I don't want my kids to be the only kids staying out of school on a Jewish holiday. I want there to be other kids who are sharing that experience, who are, in a sense, creating an atmosphere in which it's comfortable to observe Jewish holidays, to stay out of school and go to synagogue instead.
The Jewish community in Bexley is one of the first things people think of when they consider diversity in the city. It's also true that there's diversity within Bexley's Jewish community.
Orthodoxy presents the most rigid and unchanging approach to that lifestyle, and most rigid in its interpretation of a traditional text. The conservative movement is more liberal in its interpretation of text and in its approach to change, and yet contains still that commitment to traditional practice that builds a lifestyle that we believe is central to maintaining Jewish life. The Reform movement is the most liberal, the most flexible. If you walk into a Reform congregation, you'll see something that will much more resemble contemporary religious worship in other religions.
A barely noticeable border around Bexley and the adjoining neighborhoods of Berwick and Eastmore is vitally important to many Jews. A series of wires, utility lines, and natural boundaries establishes an area that's beneficial to the very observant.
It is taught by Jewish law that we're not supposed to carry outside of our homes or of our property on the Sabbath. So that becomes awkward and challenging. If you live in a courtyard that's enclosed, you can carry in the courtyard. In modern times, we have expanded that dramatically so that we can regard whole neighborhoods as if they were one courtyard.
The Eruv allows people to push and carry things on the Sabbath. Strollers, babies, medicine, keys. Every Thursday, a rabbi inspects the Eruv to ensure it's intact. If there's a break, people are alerted by a telephone hotline.
And with the support of the local authorities, and somewhat of a wink, because as I said, it really is all a legal fiction, we say this is all one big neighborhood, and within that neighborhood, then, it is permitted to carry on the Sabbath. And that makes it comfortable for people who are observant of those requirements.
An Eruv marks a boundary and creates a separate place. But a longtime Bexley institution unites the Jewish community in all of Central Ohio. It has its origins as the Schoenthal Center downtown on Rich Street. It was based on the settlement house model that was designed to Americanize European immigrants. But after World War II, there was a different need.
A real movement began to create a true community center where Jews of every background, whether you were Reform or conservative or Orthodox, no matter where you lived, they really wanted to create a centralized location for all these people to meet.
Located at College in Livingston on a campus with many other organizations that are vital to the Jewish community, it's technically just outside of Bexley. Still, it serves all sorts of people with countless activities.
There were art classes, there were dance classes, there were lots of study groups and literary magazines, and all of these things came out of the Jewish Center. They were very much involved in the cultural life of Columbus and national cultural issues. The Jewish Center also became the home for a lot of organizations that had been scattered throughout the city. You see the Columbus Hebrew School move also from Rich Street, but they moved out east as well.
A lot of the Jewish kids of Bexley, after school, would get on a school bus and be schlepped to Hebrew School. And there may have been a couple who loved it, but look, let's be frank. No 11, 12-year-old boy really wants to be schlepped to Hebrew School. It really messes up your chance to play baseball and basketball and football in the backyard. But we did it. We knew we were going to be bar mitzvahed in another year or two, and that was something that our families took very seriously.
So all of the neighborhood kids would come there, all of the Berwick and Eastmore kids. You saw a lot of the Bexley kids. The swimming pool was enormous. They also would be involved with gallery players and have an actual, almost like a theatrical presentation in the pool. Gallery Players, which is the community theater group, was actually formed because Jews weren't able to get into other theater groups in Columbus. It gave the Jewish actors and actresses a community theater. In 1953, the play Hasty Heart was the first integrated theatrical production by Gallery Players, and in 1957 they did Finian's Rainbow, another hugely successful theatrical production, which was integrated and drew a lot of attention across the city. The bowling alley at the Jewish Center also was the first integrated bowling alley. It was part of the B'nai B'rith Women's Bowling League.
I've just joined the Men's Jewish Bowling League. I joined it yesterday. I've got a team called the Introverts. And I don't want to talk about it.
The Jewish Community Center is something that is really more of the larger community. There are lots of people that work out there from all over the community, and there are people who send their children to the camps in the summertime and to the preschool during the school year who are not Jewish because it's a good quality program.
An amazing variety of programs has been offered at the center. Everything from the City Art League show to Country Heartthrob Conway Twitty's comeback concert.
He wanted this small group to actually be the cover of his new album that was coming out. So he did that with the AZA, which is the Boys B'nai B'rith organization group.
Main Street may be Bexley's greatest common denominator, the place where everyone visits community institutions. Get off this busy street, though, and you see some of the diversity that's not always obvious in Bexley.
Yeah, even as a kid, you know that north of Broad Street, generally, are where the biggest, wealthiest houses are.
North Bexley has the broadest diversity of housing stock. You can find pretty much the house you're looking for, the apartment even that you're looking for in North Bexley.
Mostly the very wealthy were in the north part of Bexley. Middle income in the middle.
And south of Main are not quite as affluent. But South Bexley feels to me as I walk around it like a traditional American neighborhood in the sense where you know who's next to you on each side.
I think a whole lot of folks move to South Bexley on purpose. They can have access to the Bexley City Schools and to all the things that Bexley offers at a more reasonable investment.
It does feel like the neighbors are more neighbors in the general sense because the yards are smaller. You're right next to each other. In far north Bexley, I mean, some of those houses are so big, you know, it seems like the lawns are as big as the Bexley football stadium.
I do think that people are aware of that sort of categorization, North Bexley, Central Bexley, South Bexley. But at the end of the day, everybody here lives in Bexley, in that Bexley community.
Bexley has very diverse architecture. You can look in North Bexley and you tend to see a lot of revival styles, English revival, French revival, Spanish revival. South Bexley, south of Broad Street, tends to be a little bit different. You do find some of the revival styles. You tend to find more of what we call vernacular architecture. They don't follow a particular stylistic pattern, but employ the elements of a lot of different styles.
When people say Bexley's a walkable community, they're often referring to the beautiful, mature trees that line the streets and fill the yards. But the American Institute of Architects has identified notable Bexley buildings and houses in its guidebook to Columbus.
And it was done by the local AIA chapter, the idea being we were going to celebrate the great historic buildings that we still have in Columbus, but also a lot of the good contemporary architecture that's been created over the past several years.
Today, people know it as the place to go for proms, parties, and summer camp. However, the Jeffrey Mansion was once home to one of Columbus's most distinguished families.
The house was designed by prominent Columbus architect Frank Packard, who was well known in Columbus and in Ohio, was one of the better architects, one of the best actually in his particular field. The family only lived there until 1941, when it was given to the city of Bexley for public purposes, and it is still publicly owned by the city, and there's a park around it, the former Jeffrey Land, and it's a real asset for the community. The governor's mansion was built in 1925 as the Malcolm Jeffrey home. He was a member of the Jeffrey mining manufacturing family. And the style is similar to that of the Robert Jeffrey home that was donated in 1941 to Bexley. This was donated in 1957 to the state of Ohio for use as the governor's mansion. They're both examples of a style called Jacobean Revival, which is a kind of made-up term that blends the term Jacobean and Elizabethan. And what it refers to is one of those picturesque revival styles of the early 20th century up into the 1920s and even the 30s. Maybe this is appropriate for a community that takes its name from the name of an English city. There's still nothing quite like Sessions Village. This is French in origin, Normandy in particular, designed to look like a French provincial village. And the architect, Robert Reeves, and the developer, Duane Fulton, traveled to France and traveled around and took notes and took photos and really studied the architecture of these villages. It was intended as a suburban enclave, obviously for well-to-do people, intended to not only get them out of the city, but also sort of keep them away from everybody else who's living around them, almost like the idea of the gated community today. I think probably somebody coming from Normandy would say, oh, this looks very familiar.
St. Charles Academy is one of the first buildings you see when heading east into Bexley on Broad Street. It suggests yet another European architectural influence.
It has elements of the Spanish revival style as opposed to some of the English and French-inspired architecture elsewhere in Bexley. It's in a big H shape. It was built actually as a seminary, but has been a private boys' school for many years. St. Catherine is interesting. It's so different from most of what you see or expect to see in architecture in Bexley. It really, even though it was built in the early 1960s, it has a strong reflection back to that modernist movement of the 1930s, the Art Moderne movement, where European architects, and in Germany in particular, were beginning to look at a very spare, unornamented, geometric kind of architecture that became known as Art Moderne. But it's not something you expect to see, and it really stands out as a landmark in the streetscape in Bexley. That's one of the interesting things about Bexley. The community isn't afraid of trying something new. There are some other residential buildings that are a somewhat later expression of that same modernism movement. One is the house built by architect Novair Mussin for himself on Clifton. It would stand up well against anything being designed today, and it was built over 50 years ago. He did a house for a friend of his not far away in Parkview, Dixie Miller, who was a strong supporter of good design, good architecture, and one of the founders of the Columbus Landmarks Foundation. She lived in a very modern house designed by Novair Mussin in the 1950s. And that, too, would measure up well against anything being done today as contemporary architecture.
Another house in Bexley is noteworthy not for the architecture, but because of who lived there. In 1964, Jerry Mock was a Bexley housewife and flying enthusiast. Eager for adventure, she realized no woman had flown solo around the world.
She didn't even have 700 hours when she took off. So she really was flying for pleasure. And even when she took this flight, it was for fun and adventure.
But what Mach imagined as a chance to visit exotic global locales became a race with an experienced professional pilot who was trying to complete a solo trip at the same time. Mach's husband, a PR man who had arranged sponsorships and news coverage of her flight, exhorted her to keep pressing on. Weather delays, mechanical problems, international red tape, and cultural biases against women all conspired against her.
She sometimes had challenges even getting mechanical work done because, again, the folks who were doing the work were waiting for a man to come and give the go sign.
Finally, Mach was successful and was hailed as a hero at Port Columbus. But she would never be as famous as her childhood hero, Amelia Earhart. Mach didn't care for the limelight and fell out of the public eye. She returned to Bexley and later moved to Florida, where she died in 2014.
She was an adventurer. She had a great time. She always trusted her plane to do what it was supposed to and trusted herself to know what to do.
Alfred Tibor also has an amazing life story. His sculptures can be found around the world and in all parts of Bexley. After fleeing his native Hungary, Tibor eventually made his home in Columbus. Many of his pieces at Bexley synagogues, schools, and buildings come from his Holocaust experiences. He was imprisoned in Russia. When he was finally freed, his family was gone.
273 people, two of us survived.
His largest and most ambitious creation is a Holocaust memorial at Trinity Lutheran Seminary in Bexley.
In a lot of your sculpture, you have people raising their hands or reaching for something.
All the time.
Why is that?
It is very simple. There is no other way I could show a human being. The flame is always the surviving. I am a survivor.
Moses Judah Folkman was required to complete a science project at Bexley High, and his was epic. He kept a rat's heart beating outside the body using a bicycle tire pump and his sister's toy oven. This Bexley High School grad would become one of the world's leading cancer researchers.
He had the notion that all tumors must have a supply of blood, and that was in the early 70s, and that was an idea that he put forth that was largely not rebuffed, but met coolly from the scientific community at the time in the early 70s. But in fact, intuitively, now today, we know it makes sense. It's a vital principle upon which we base many treatments these days.
His father was one of Bexley's beloved rabbis. He hoped his son would follow in his footsteps. Recognizing his son's gifts, he encouraged him to become a rabbi-like doctor. Moses Judah Folkman was respected for his research and loved for the sensitivity and compassion he showed others.
Dr. Folkman was an extraordinary teacher, physician, and researcher, so he kept the promise to his dad as teacher. Tragically, we lost Dr. Folkman in 2008. He would be thrilled with the progress we've made in angiogenesis research.
Well, today was our annual Judah Folkman Scientist in Residence program. We bring in a respected scientist from across the country, preferably an alumnus at Bexley High School, and we provide an opportunity for students to be inspired by their work and to be able to interact with someone of that caliber. We have an endowment fund at the Bexley Education Foundation named in honor of Judah Folkman, primarily established by his classmates from the Bexley High School class of 1950. We're proud of our heritage here in Bexley, and I think any time a student can know about someone like Judah Folkman, I think that inspires them, and they think, well, perhaps, you know, maybe I can be that. That next breakthrough might come through a student here in Bexley.
Thank you very much. Appreciate your time.
Bexley's public school system is
probably among the strongest in the state of Ohio and beyond.
We spend top 22 school districts in the state of Ohio per pupil expenditure, and absolutely everything that I can think of. The more you're able to spend on an item, the higher the quality, generally. If you have $40,000 a year to spend on a car, and I have five, that experience in that car is going to be quite different. So I think the community here understands that, and we've been delivering high quality, and so they're willing to continue to spend at those levels to get the kind of educational experience for their children.
It attracts the kind of person that doesn't mind paying for education, although we all hate taxes. They also want to be involved with their students' education.
When school's in session, Bexley's in the classroom, either as students or working at institutions that are among Bexley's largest employers, the city school system, Capital, Columbus School for Girls, and St. Charles Academy.
So students and children come from all over the county to attend the Columbus School for Girls and St. Charles. A number of our own students go to those schools, and we see that as a real positive for us because it's a benchmark that we see as excellent.
I think it's entirely appropriate to consider Bexley as a city of education. I will say that Capital is largely responsible for that. Capital took that cornfield and converted it over time into a thriving institution of higher education.
Well, Capital University's had an enormous influence on Central Ohio, you could say on America as a whole. It's produced a wide variety of diverse and distinguished teachers, administrators, educators, and so on.
It really ought to be called Education City because that's one of the things people value the most here.
We moved from Marion Village, and we wanted to start a family, and the schools in Bexley are really great, and so it was a pretty logical move for us. When you grow up and you're going to have a family, this is where all the people from German Village and downtown come to move. Two or three of our neighbors have all moved from German Village, and we all kind of moved together at the same time, same point in life.
The schools are really what brought us here. You can't get better than Bexley schools.
As Bexley looks to the future, there's a recognition that a city that may not have been very diverse is becoming more so. The qualities that distinguish Bexley, its schools, its location, its small town sensibilities, will continue to draw people to the city. The Bexley City Schools created a position for someone to help the community think about the challenges ahead.
The truth is that Bexley, when it was founded as a community, did not have a lot of race or socioeconomic diversity in it. This shift feels pretty new. I get to see what diversity looks like inside of the schools. I would venture to say that Bexley is much more diverse than people think, even more than I thought. It could be same-sex families, it could be multiracial families, it could be adoptive families, many more African-American community members in Bexley than I realized. And also a little more faith and religion, more spiritual diversity.
Kristallnacht, the night of broken glass. Jews and Christians have gathered in Bexley to remember the dark night in 1938 when Nazis plundered and destroyed Jewish homes, businesses, and places of worship in Germany. It's an interfaith gathering. People here are classmates and next-door neighbors. The service is at Trinity Lutheran Seminary, where students were once required to be fluent in German. Today, the foreign language requirement is Spanish.
This is a community that started out as an enclave for the Lutheran community, and it then became an enclave for the Jewish community. And the two communities coexisted so wonderfully together. And I think Bexley was one of the first communities to be open to that sort of integration and diversity.
This is a destination location. People want to be here, and for a great reason. It's beautiful. The school system is amazing. I mean, the resources are mind-blowing.
Mind-blowing. That's a term some people might associate with an institution that's perhaps even more beloved than the schools.
You know, you asked me to describe the pizza at Rubino's. The word I always say to people is it's indescribable. I don't mean it's delicious, but it is. It's my favorite pizza in the world. But I try to tell them what it's like. I must have eaten, a million pizzas here? I can't describe it. I'm thinking, is there cheese on it? What makes it so special?
The phone would ring. Frank, the main guy would give the phone a karate chop, and the receiver would go up in his hand. He said, "Rubino's," and that was something you just remember the rest of your life. And when he would give you your change, it was always 505, 605, 705, and that's no jive. It's virtually nothing, but it's when you're young and it's part of your shared history, there's something special about it.
Well, what we know about pizza is that whatever pizza you grew up on is the best pizza in the world. And that's the pizza I grew up on. So I measure all pizza against, well, does this like Rubino's? And it never is.
We always like to joke that Rubino's pizza had a crust that was so thin that the local rabbis ruled you were allowed to eat it during Passover because it was basically unleavened bread like matzah. Now some rabbi's gonna call it, if you use it, that's sacrilegious. Okay, whatever. Okay, I'll say that. Well, Jews are big in comedy, okay? So it's comedy, okay. Yeah, okay.
But when I see Rubino's, when I see Johnson's, when I see the top, it's almost like they're people. They're not buildings. They're people I grew up with. And in some cases, actual people, the people who still run them. So yeah, this is, if a business can be home, these places on Main Street are home.
A sense of home pervades just about everything in this small town in a big city. It's evident every year on the 4th of July. Independence Day is a sort of homecoming in Bexley. It's another institution that's grounded in tradition.
The July 4th parade is fabulous. It's just great. It's humble and loving, and it's just a very sweet experience.
So we have about 110 participants this year who will line up for our 2.5 mile parade that starts at 9:30. We've done this for almost 55 years now, and we have almost 300 people when it all comes down to the numbers of people who participate in this year's parade.
The July 4th parade is truly like Groundhog's Day. If you've been to the Bexley Parade once, you've seen it every year it's ever been held.
What's really great about it is you see, oh, there's the remnants of the class of 1948. They sure look old, don't they? Oh, there's the class of 58. Oh, yeah, they're not looking too good either. Hey, wait a minute, I'm about that same age, you know.
We tend to be much more isolated in our homes than people were a generation or two ago. So when July 4th comes and people are out and people are sitting in front of their houses and people are greeting their neighbors and people are walking down the streets, it's a real community event, the kind of which we don't have very much in most places. And it's a non-denominational, non-sectarian opportunity for people to get out, to see each other. It's a Bexley tradition that I really love.
Many cities have less crossover, less friendships than we do here, across religious lines and across religious lines within any one religion. It's a tolerant and accommodating place. I think people feel lucky to be here, and so why make trouble?
As a diversity practitioner, we hear constant data about by 2050, the world's gonna look remarkably different. And as a biracial person, I can say, you know, they say the world's gonna look much more like me. We're catching up here at Bexley with that. Now we're primed to be leaders in that conversation. Truly, I believe the intellectual capital of Columbus, Ohio is sitting in Bexley. So the minds are here. I think the readiness is here.
And one of the things that's so great about Bexley is that you have this community that takes together the mansion streets, and it has middle income streets, and everybody is kind of united by this shared core of common values. Common values about raising families, about having a neighborhood that's purposeful and intentional, that's focused on education. And those are common values that bring people together regardless of their racial, socioeconomic, religious background. And I think that's what Bexley is about. It's those shared common values.
The one thing about Bexley, especially in summer, is when the streetlights go on. The day is done, and all of a sudden, the streetlights will come on, and when we were kids, it was a signal you had to be home. And it was like an alarm clock at night. You would be out, and everything would feel kind of nice and safe. And then the streetlights coming on would be like your parents tugging you and saying it's time to come home. And so whenever I happen to be out in the evening now in Bexley and the streetlights come on, I think, well, it's time to get home, even if it's not. The streetlights mean it's time to go home.
Support for Columbus Neighborhoods is provided by Since 1921, the State Auto Group has called Columbus Neighborhoods home, offering personal and business insurance through independent insurance agents. For your car, home, and business, the State Auto Group. As we've grown and changed with Columbus, we've never lost sight of one thing. We are neighbors serving neighbors. Chase and its more than 15,000 Central Ohio associates are proud to celebrate the historic neighborhoods of Columbus. American Electric Power Foundation, a resource for charitable initiatives and communities served by AEP and beyond to improve people's lives through education, basic needs, healthcare, and the arts. The law firm of Bailey Cavalieri, a local firm with a national presence, baileycavalieri.com. And by these and other local foundations and families, and viewers like you. Thank you.
Order your copy of Columbus Neighborhoods Bexley on DVD for $19.95 at wosu.org/shop.